each year as we begin the Advent season, we try to do a little something special and focusing our hearts and minds on that. And this year, I'd like to focus on four themes these coming weeks. Today, the theme of love. Next week, joy and peace and hope. And as we light these candles, and we'll try to darken the auditorium here, and Darlene this morning is going to play through the song Silent Night. And I'd invite you to think about that theme of love, and think specifically about people you know who might not feel love, or could maybe feel even unwanted. I thought of children in our foster care system, maybe being bounced around to different places, feeling unwanted, unloved. I thought about many marriages in our communities that struggle or have are already experiencing the pain and the scars of divorce and have experienced a lot of hate and anger. So maybe someone specific has come to your mind that you could think and pray about for a moment. If not, you can pray for those categories in general. Children feeling unwanted or struggling marriages. If you're near a window, you can close the curtain, and when she's done playing, then we can turn the lights back on.
Thank you. stand and do the same.
You are holy, you are nice.
May be seated. We're going to turn to page number 524, amendment accounts. I would like to do this as a closing prayer, so we will add an amen. Page 524.
Please use our continued continued time together here to bring you glory and to help us on our journey following you. Jesus, amen. Does anyone remember from last Sunday, either the those who were here, either the main question that I asked or the theme of the message? There's kind of one main question, and there was a theme to the message. Anybody remember that? A lot of people not making eye contact. So the one main question was, oh, someone's waving back there.
The kingdom of God.
The kingdom of God was the theme, and there was one question we were asking. What matters most? What matters most? So in our lives, that's something we should be asking, and I think Jesus was encouraging people to ask, what matters most? Was encouraging us to seek first the kingdom, seek God's kingdom first, and all this other stuff, it'll work out. Those things are important too, but seek his kingdom first. You've seen in the bulletin, and it was referenced already, that today's theme is on lost and found. And these themes of Jesus, I think, are so foundational. He cares about the kingdom. He cares about us belonging and us inviting other people to belong. And this idea of lost and found goes right along with that. What things have you lost? What things have you lost? It's not even like spiritual stuff, just like, what things have you lost? Have you lost your keys? Experienced that? Glasses? You lost your glasses? Library books, relate, or DVDs that you borrow, like, where is this? Adventures in Odyssey. Here's the case, where's the... What else have you lost? Was it your family that had some animals you were chasing last week? You didn't lose them, but they were out. I remember that happening at home. Cows are out, the steers are out, the whatever. Have you ever lost things in the laundry? Like socks, you know? There used to be two of these. Where did the one go? I don't know, it disappeared.
All knowledge of my location.
All lost. Where you are? Where am I? Where am I going? Money? I was asking some people, I was thinking about this, things they've lost. Some people lost money, contact lenses. They lost one of those. I remember, I think we were still dating. We ended up, a friend and I, tearing a sink drain apart because someone was sure it was in the trap, and thankfully it was. Passwords. What was my password to this? I wrote it down somewhere. Now it's lost. A mouth retainer. Remember that one, Bethany? She was younger. After having braces, she had a mouth retainer. We were at Oregon Dairy. Wrapped it up in a napkin. Got discarded. We called the guy. Lord bless him, the trash had already gone out to the dumpster. He got in the dumpster, dug through the trash, and found it. Very kind. He said, that's very common. Don't ever wrap your retainer in a napkin. You're sure to throw it away. We lose stuff. And I have one other story here at this point I was going to share, and I really wanted my wife to share it, but she didn't. Most of my memory of this story is sleeping, but so one night, this is many years ago, we lived at Woodcrest in a trailer. I think we had two children, maybe. Apparently, occasionally, I do a little sleepwalking. It's not real common, but this night, in the middle of the night, she woke up and I wasn't there in bed. And so she started walking around our trailer, not very big, but she couldn't find me. Started getting a little worried. It was in the summer, and occasionally I would do work in the office at weird hours. She checked the office, I wasn't there. She called the office, no one answered. There's another building, she called that building, I wasn't there. She looked out on the back deck, I wasn't there. Starting to get a little worried, contemplating calling my parents to come and help look because she didn't want to leave our young children alone. The light switch to our backyard was kind of up high, and because of where we had to place our bunk bed, kind of had to climb up on the bunk bed to get to this light switch. She climbs up the bunk bed, and there I'm sleeping in the top bunk bed. Bethany was normally there because it was so hot, was sleeping on the floor, so I was, for some reason, sleeping up at the top of the bunk bed. She has passed the feeling of relief. She was to the phase of anger. And so I awake to like a punch. What are you doing up here? I don't know, I'm sleeping. But for a while, I was lost. And that was very stressful to me. When something is lost, our effort or how much our response, the degree of effort we put into finding it, reveals at least two things. One, it reveals how valuable that thing is, whether it's worth looking for. Another thing it reveals is our degree of hope that we might actually find it. So, if you have something like, the sock in the laundry might not be of great value. So we actually have a little basket of all the lost socks. So someday if the other orange and black sock ever turns up, this one will be waiting for it. But we're not hunting everywhere for that sock anymore because it's not a big deal. Kelly's mother, I think, lost a diamond at one point. So that was a big deal. Depending on where you lose it, you may have little hope of it being found. You know, the contact lens coming out in the ocean. You know, it's of significant value, but is there a chance that I'm going to find it? Not much. Did just a bit of research, and in June of 1969, perhaps some of you remember this, I don't know, there was a six-year-old boy named Dennis Martin who wandered away from his family in the Great Smoky Mountains. 1,400 people were in on that search party. They spent over 13,000 man hours and over 200 helicopter hours were logged, searching for little Denny. He unfortunately was never found. More recently, in March of 2014, most of us would remember the Malaysian Airlines Flight 370. That has become the most expensive aircraft search to date. Over $70 million was spent in that search. If you have a Bible, I'd invite you to turn to Luke chapter 15. Jesus is using these stories of lost and found for a reason. And in the beginning of Luke chapter 15, there's kind of a problem. Jesus sees the church people not caring about something, and the church people see Jesus doing something, and they perceive that as a problem. From the people's perspective, Jesus, if you look in the first couple verses of chapter 15, tax collectors and sinners were gathering around to hear Jesus. The Pharisees and teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." So there's a problem. The problem is they're muttering about Jesus is spending time with these people who are sinful. And then Jesus, for the rest of the chapter, is telling these stories of lost and found. And his perspective of the problem is, you're the church people, and you not only aren't going and relating to these lost people, but now you're muttering against me when I'm spending time with them. That's the problem that we have here. It's important to know when we look at this situation that Jesus was welcoming these sinners. He was eating with them, but it doesn't say that he's approving of their lifestyle or what they're doing. He's not endorsing their sinful behavior, but he is welcoming them and spending time with them. And indeed, it says that they had come gather around to hear him. So they want to know what he has to say. The church people were basically ignoring those people or rejecting them, and even beyond that, muttering against anyone who would try to reach out to them. It made me ask the question, what was it about Jesus that caused the sinners to want to gather around and hear him? Perhaps it was that he wasn't condemning. He wasn't rejecting them. Perhaps it was partly because of the miracles he was doing. Maybe he was even involving some of them in the miracles and bringing healing and life to them. His intention always was to bring them back. There's three accounts we have here. In verses 3 to 7, we have the story of the lost sheep. Then Jesus told them this parable. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Does he not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. And he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost sheep." I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. I remember a story when we were younger, we had a pony. And different times animals would get out. One time, one of our ponies got out and we couldn't find it. And it ran away. And I'm not sure, maybe mom and dad, maybe you remember, I don't know how many days it was, but I think someone from Adamstown called and had found our pony. And that was rejoicing because we thought this pony was gone. Verses 8 to 10, the lost coin. Or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Does she not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost coin." In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. Asked their children if they had any special coins and came up with this box of these silver dollars. says, there's a note in it, says Bethany and Caleb Silver Dollar for turning 5 years old. So I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. There's supposed to be 10. There's one lost somewhere. And I think I mistakenly taped it to the bottom of a pew. So if anyone's nimble enough to look under your pew, you can see if the bench, there's a coin anywhere. See if we can find this lost coin. I think it's maybe towards the back over there. And there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to eat in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of the country, who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired men have food to spare, and here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men.' So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate, for this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard the music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him, 'What was going on?' 'Your brother has come,' he replied, 'and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound.' But the older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, 'Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours who has squandered your property with prostitutes comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him.' 'My son,' the father said, 'you are always with me and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad, because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.'" Two other little stories came to mind as I was reading that. This idea of being, he says he was dead and is alive again. It reminded me of the true story of a man named Louis Zamperini. Book broken in a movie. And incredible story of a man who went through lots of plane wreck in the ocean, 40-some days, I think, out at sea, then being captured by enemies and being a prisoner of war. But he was presumed dead. And at one point, he actually is put on the radio and is realized back home that he's living. And I think in his account, his wife had actually, they'd actually received his life insurance for him dying. And he was someone who was perceived dead and now is alive again. There's also a movie that our family has watched. I think we got it at the Christian Library. It's called The Way Home. It's a true story of a family whose two-year-old boy wanders off into the woods near their home, and this incredible search for him, he is found. There's songs that speak of this idea of being lost and found. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, now I'm found. There's a song, Forever Grateful. I think one of the lines is, thanking God that we're forever grateful that He came to seek and save the lost. Each of these three stories that Jesus uses have some things in common. There was something that was lost. There was seeking or looking or watching for that something. That something is found. And then there is celebration. And celebration with other people. It's interesting to me that the whole purpose of, it seems like, the whole purpose of Jesus telling these stories, these parables, was to show them that they aren't looking for something of value. These people here that you're calling sinners, tax collectors, they are lost. And you're taking no effort. You're not caring about them. In fact, you're muttering against me, Jesus is saying, when I try to interact with them. And he gives them these examples of, you know, which of you, if you lost a sheep, wouldn't go look for it? Or if someone lost a coin, wouldn't you go look for it? Or this father and the son, wouldn't you be watching for that son to be returning? That's how God is with us as people, and it's how we as followers of Christ should be with others. When I look at an outline of a sermon, one of the templates that I kind of use as introduction, scripture, one of the categories is personal, like to try to relate it to something personal in your life. And so as I was thinking about this, it's kind of easy, and there's fun stories about losing a sock or a diamond or coins, but to kind of do what Jesus did was a little more challenging. So he was reaching out to people that most people didn't want to spend time with. And in fact, he was getting rebuked because of reaching out to those people. So that was more of a challenge for me to think of, okay, when have I done that? When have you done that? For a couple years, I was playing in an over 40 soccer league, and most of the guys I was playing with, I would guess, were not believers, at least not practicing. But sometimes they would have a little after game party where they'd sit around and drink and just talk. And on one occasion, I decided to go. And it was very awkward for me because I was the only one not drinking. But it was something that I felt led to do. I think, hopefully, for that purpose, that I was trying to reach out to people who maybe weren't connected with Christ. I remember on one occasion, a prayer group that I was with, one of the guys from another church said, "Hey, there's a few of us that are doing Christmas caroling to some local bars." That's an interesting idea. And they invited me to come along. And I and actually Daryl went along with me. There was only like four or five of us. We went into, I think, five or six bars in the area and just asked them if we could sing Christmas carols. One guy had a guitar, and that was really interesting experience. We were received very well. There was a problem. The church people perceived it as a problem that Jesus was associating with these people. Jesus saw it as a problem that they weren't, and that they were even rebuking him for doing it. Jesus' perspective is to seek and save the lost. There's a bookmark that I put on the back table that I'd invite you to consider taking. The challenge would be for you this week to do something each day to try to do what Jesus did, to seek and save the lost. Jesus, there's a verse for each day. Several times in Jesus' life, this is what he was about. The woman who was caught in adultery, and what was his response to her? "I don't condemn you, but go and leave your life in sin." Jesus was trying to seek and save the lost. He talks about it's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. This is the heart of Jesus. Lost or found, Jesus cares about you and wants you in the kingdom to become more like him. If you're already a part of his family, he wants you to care and seek and save the lost. And also be ready to celebrate when someone does return. If you're not a part of this family yet, he's inviting you. Regardless of what baggage you have, what you've done in your past, how you might feel rejected by other people, Jesus died for you. Rose again and offers you new life. It's up to you to receive it. So what can we do to reach, to seek and save the lost? We can pray. We can pray for someone. We can have prayerful interaction for someone we interact with. Instead of just talking about the Eagles game, whisper a prayer or silently as you're talking to that person. Have an attitude of your heart that God, could something of my interaction with him or her point them to you? Maybe it's calling someone. Maybe it's writing them a note, sending a message. Maybe it's accepting an invitation from them to join them in some setting, like my example of the after soccer party. Maybe it's eating with them. Consider, maybe you could do something each day this week to seek and save someone who's lost, and be ready to celebrate. I'd also like to comment on that word lost. You know, sometimes we lose things and they're right under our nose, or they're still in our house, or probably that other sock is somewhere close by. The contact lens is sometimes right on our clothing. Sometimes people so close to us are lost, and they're only one step away from returning. And also mention today at the end of the service, if there's someone that you'd specifically like to pray for, and you would like to pray together for that person, I'll stay up front here a little afterwards. I would welcome the opportunity to pray with you about someone who is on your heart. May we be people who seek and save the lost, like our Lord. Please pray. God, thank you that you are a God who sought us. You have reached out to save us. Forgive us, God, when we are so exclusive that we don't care about the people who have not yet been found. Help us, Lord, to have a heart to seek and save, to not approve of sinful behavior, but not reject a person just because that's what their journey is right now. Help us to be welcoming and yet bearing truth like you did. In a way that miraculously these people gathered around you. Help us to attract others to us. And our ultimate prayer, God, is that the lost will be found. In Jesus' name.
Thank you.
have a special prayer for the China team, so I invite today's team to come forward. So we just sang about this shepherd who went far to go find the lost, and we're making a long plane ride. Remember that plane ride. I want to pray as they're going. You're leaving next Sunday early sometime. Pray for them as they go. Pray for the people who they'll interact with, the message that is shared. Pray for encouragement for Esther and other believers there in China. So, maybe you could stand with me. If you feel comfortable with it, you can just extend your hand towards them and pray together. Father, we ask for your blessing on this team. God, we pray and thank you that you do go before them. Thank you that you're preparing the interactions that they'll have with people from halfway around the world. God, we pray that you would bring clarity to their message, that language would not be a barrier, that you would enable them to communicate well, that you would enable those who hear the message to understand. We pray for Esther and others who are shining your light there in China, for encouragement for them, for strength, and that your message would grow, prosper, and flourish. We pray for safety, a wonderful time for them together as a team. We commit them to you in the name of Jesus. Everyone said, amen. What other things would you like to share with the group?
This is Nina Brown. I related to this sermon very well this morning because, and my parents are no longer here, I can't get any more details. But I was told that I was lost as a child. I was found in the cornfield fast asleep. I had cried myself to sleep. A neighbor lady found me, so I'm not even sure how many people helped to look for me when combing the cornfield to find me. And I said, "Pop, shut the gate." Apparently my father didn't know that I had followed him, and he left the chicken yard and shut the gate, and I didn't know how to go home. So I'm glad today that I was found then. And I'd also like to say that I was lost in another way, but Jesus found me, and I'm glad I was found twice.
Thank you. God, thank you so much for loving us enough to seek us and find us. Help us to care about those around us.